So thank you for the introduction, and I'd like to thank the organizer for giving me this opportunity to speak in this wonderful event. And I also apologize that I don't have anything to say on Perfectoid space. And also I apologize that I'm giving a slight talk which generally no one likes, but it has too many notations and I tried to give a word talk and it didn't work, so this time I'm trying slides. Okay, so, but I don't have too many slides. So. Okay, so, so even before starting, so the organization of the talk is the following. So I'll first give a motivation and recall some results of Mazur and Rubin, which puts it into context. And then I'll state our main result, and then I'll give a second motivation coming from the analytic side, so say something about p-adic functions. And then I'll say, give a few stray remarks about the proof, and at the end discuss a few numerical examples. Okay, so let me start. So let E over Q be an elliptic curve. Then we know that the Q rational points, EQ is a finitely generated abelian group. It's Model's theorem, and more generally, for any number field, it's Model-Weil theorem. So the way when we first read elliptic curves, the way the proof works, that we first prove weak Model-Weil theorem, and so EQ mod some n times EQs injects into what is called n Selmer group, and that is shown to be finite, and that's how we prove weak Model-Weil theorem. So that's how we come across Selmer group. So the definition, n Selmer group of elliptic curve. So you fix a integer n, and then n Selmer group of elliptic curve is defined to be this kernel of Galois cohomology group. So it's a global Galois cohomology group with coefficient en, n torsion point of the elliptic curve. And then you have this restriction map. For each prime L, you have this decomposition subgroup GQL by class field theory. It can be seen as a decomposition subgroup. So you have this restriction map at every prime L, and you look at the kernel. Then this is the n Selmer group. And as I said, the way we prove weak Model-Weil theorem is that EQ mod n times EQ injects into this n Selmer group, and then the quotient is what is known as Tetschafer-Wiedl group, the n part of that. And this is supposed to be, by Bershonnet and Dyer conjecture, this is supposed to be finite, so these two groups are closely related. So for example, if I take n to be a prime, then the FP rank of this, of P Selmer group, will be an upper bound on the Z rank of EQ, because EQ is a finitely generated abelian group. So the FP rank of this will be upper bound on the Z rank of this. Okay. So, so there has been a lot of interest in study of n Selmer group of late, and the study of n Selmer group indeed has led to discovery of some of the deep results in the arithmetic of elliptic curves. So let me say a few things, a few examples of that. So for example, I just now said that the P Selmer group will give a upper bound on the Z rank of the Model-Weil group. So, celebrated work of Manjul Bhargava and others has given upper bound on this average rank of P Selmer group for certain small primes. And using that property of, on an average property of Model-Weil group can be determined. And then you can say, on an average, Bershonnet and Dyer conjecture holds and so on. But I'm not going to say anything about this in this talk. There is also a series of very deep and influential papers by Mazur and Rubin on the study of n Selmer group, and I'm going to say a bit more about that. Okay, so they have a series, as I said, they have series of papers in n Selmer groups, many of them very, very fundamental results. So for example, what they discuss, they take two Selmer group, and they fix an elliptic curve and take quadratic twist of the elliptic curve. And so E is fixed, and Q actually, so actually here I've written Q, but also for number field K. So E and K are fixed, and you look at the chi varies over all quadratic character of GQ, and then you look at the quadratic twist of the elliptic curve. Then you see, so this is a, then it's a F2 finitely generated, I mean, it's a, what is the F2 rank? How does F2 rank varies? This is one of the topics they discuss. So for example, in one of the papers, they settle this open problem that is in this, that they prove that given any k over a number field, there exists an elliptic curve with ek equal to 0. And on the other hand, in the same paper, on the other end of the spectrum, they show that given k, they discuss they give sufficient condition under which the two Selmer group can have arbitrarily large F2 rank. So given any r, they can produce many examples given an e under some mild condition, like it should not have two torsion over q or over k. Then they produce that many twist. Many there is definition in the sense of analytic number theory that has arbitrarily large F2 rank. So on the other hand, so I defined the N Selmer group, then this P infinity Selmer group. So taking direct limit of P to the power N Selmer group, one can define P infinity Selmer group. And this is a cofinitely generated ZP module, and they produced a large Selmer rank. So given certain quadratic, certain dihedral extension of of certain field small k, capital K over small k, some dihedral extension of order 2 p to the power n, they produced that the Selmer group rank should be at least p to the power n. So they produced large ZP co-rank on the Selmer group, and this has related relation with the p-parity conjecture and so on. So one of the broad theme there has been that you fix an elliptic curve and you twist it by chi and a quadratic character chi, and you see what happens to the rank distribution of that p-Selmer group or two-Selmer group. But in one of the paper, it's named in the series of paper, one of the paper is called Selmer companion curve, and there Mazur and Rubin ask the converse question. So more precisely, what they do, they ask this question, that suppose you fix a prime p and take a number field k, then what information e over k can be obtained from this function? So you take all quadratic characters, and then you look at, as I said, e and k are fixed, and you look at the dimension, fp dimension of p Selmer group of e chi over k, as chi is varying. So this, what information can you obtain from this? So this is like moving in the converse direction. And this is what is the content of this talk. So more precisely, in this paper, they make the following definition. So take k to be a number field and n in n. Then they define two elliptic curve to be n Selmer companion if for every quadratic character chi of the Galois group of k, there is an isomorphism of n Selmer group of E1 chi over k with n Selmer group of e2 chi over k. Okay, for every chi, if that happens, then you call them to be n Selmer companion. Okay. So obviously, it immediately reduces to study of p to the power r Selmer group for prime power r's, because n Selmer group can be decomposed into p to the power r Selmer groups. So what they do in this paper, and they give a sufficient condition that two elliptic curves, when they're p to the power r Selmer companion. And this is in terms of p to the power r congruence. So if two elliptic curves are congruent mod p to the power r, and some local criteria are satisfied, then they say when they'll be p to the power r Selmer companion. And it's kind of, it has deep relation with the congruence. So in particular, so converse is also true, it's what they expect. So let me do a little bit of digression and say that. So in the same paper, they define two Selmer groups to be near, E1 and E2 to be near Selmer companion. If it need not be isomorphic, but let's say there is an abelian group A chi, and there's a homomorphism from Sn E1 chi k to S2 En chi k, and kernel and co-kernel of order at most C, okay? So for example, if it is n equal to p, then it says that the fp rank difference of p Selmer group of e1k and e2k are bounded. So there is absolute constant c, which depends only on e1, e2, and k, and not depending on chi. So So that FP rank up P Selmer group of U1 chi and E2 chi are bounded. Okay. And yeah, chi is quadratic. Throughout the talk, chi is quadratic. So, and this is enough. So this is, of course, if they're, so if they're Selmer companion, notice that if they're Selmer companion, then this is satisfied with C equal to 1, okay? So this is a weaker condition than Selmer companion. And they make this conjecture that E1 and E2 are N Selmer companion, implies that near N Selmer companion, if and only if E1 and E2 are isomorphic as GK module. So if they're near Selmer companion, then they're congruent. So if they're congruent, then they give sufficient condition when they're N-Selmer companion. And if they're N-Selmer companion, then certainly they're congruent. In fact, if a weaker thing is true, that if they're N near Selmer companion, then they're congruent, okay? So that's why this, it's a rare phenomena to be N-Selmer companion, and it captures the congruence also. And in fact, so this is the conjecture they make in the paper, and it one case. So a student of Rubin, he proves this conjecture recently, this year in fact, for n equal to 2. So he proves that if E1 and E2 are two near Selmer companion, then they are congruent mod 2. The elliptic curves are congruent mod 2, but. Yeah, but because we are dealing with quadratic character, two Selmer case is rather special. Two Selmer group and quadratic character is special. So this conjecture is very interesting, and I so what my impression is that this will not be, so his proof will not extend to general case. If you take a odd prime P, that proof, the way it is proved, it will not extend to a general case. So it is very open. Even for two power, it's also open, but so if you take, so probably if you take three Selmer group and if you change the definition, you take, instead of quadratic character, you take degree three characters, order three characters, then something like this you can prove. But quadratic characters at p odd Selmer group, it is still hard to prove. So anyhow, in the paper, one of the things they say, they suggest to investigate this phenomena. So they write that it will be interesting to investigate this for the more general motifs and for the p to the power r block cutter Selmer group. So, and all these things made us interested, and the content of this talk is the analog of this for the modular form, for the motifs coming from modular form, okay? So towards this, first we make a definition. What is the meaning of p to the power r block cutter Selmer companion for two modular forms? So I need some notation. So take a prime p. Let's say p doesn't divide n, and f1, f2 are two modular forms of weight k and character Nevin type as epsilon I, and k is the field generated by Fourier coefficients of f1, f2, and the values of the Levin typers, and pi is an uniformizer. Then we make this definition that f1, so again, f1, f2 are two normalized cuspidal eigenform, sk gamma naught ni and epsilon I. And then we say f1, f2 are p to the power, pi to the power are block cutter Selmer companion. So if for every critical twist, and for every quadratic character, the block cutter Selmer group, so this is the pi to the power r block cutter Selmer group, or f1 and f2 are isomorphic. So notice that for elliptic curve, the weight is 2, so there is only one critical value, but for a general weight k modular form, there are k minus 1 critical values, so one defines k minus 1 Selmer group, bunch of Selmer groups with them for each critical value. And so of course I will explain this notation. So this is the pi to the power r block cutter Selmer group of f1 and f2. So we need, so here their block cutter Selmer companion means that for all these k minus 1 Selmer groups are isomorphic simultaneously with each other. So if, sorry, 0 to k minus 2, I mean k minus 1 critical values ranging from 0 to k minus 2. Yes. Okay, so, but, so now I'll state the main theorem, but, and then I'll say another motivation coming from the analytic side of this. And then I'll say the proof is actually very different from elliptic curve to modular form, because in case of elliptic curve, we have a abelian variety structure and we have this Kumar map. And in case of modular form, we don't have this. So what Mazur and Rubin do, they look at the image of the Kumar map. So to prove such a statement, so what is the definition of Selmer group? Selmer group, you have some global cohomology and then you have some local cohomology. So the global cohomology, given that they are congruent, you are starting their congruence, so you will get immediately isomorphism induced by that congruence, and it reduces to study the global, the local factors. And those local factors, so Mazur Rubin, they look at the image of the Kumar map, and they, for Selmer group, P Selmer group, the local condition at P is the most difficult. And there what they do, they use FPPF cohomology or Neron model of the elliptic curve for. But here we don't have any such tools, so we have to take different methods. So I'll explain that. But anyhow, let me state my main theorem. So this is joint with Sudhansu, who is here, and also with Dipramit Majumdar, who is in IIT Madras. Okay, so take an odd prime. So one of the restrictions we have is that we can only do this for various technicalities that we come across. We could not do the p equal to 2 case, so that is excluded in our theorem. So let p be an odd prime, and f1, f2 be to normalize cuspidal eigenform, and ti are in some non-negative integers. And so I will explain, this is the discrete lattice. So let me write, I'll explain again. So given a modular form, I get a, from using the Galois representation, I get a vector space VF, and then I have a lattice inside this by compactness. So I'll define this to be AF. And then you can talk about pi to the power r torsion point. So this is the analog of E n torsion point of the elliptic curve, or p to the power r torsion point of the elliptic curve. So let us assume they are congruent. So let phi be a GQ linear isomorphism. And assume that n is square free. So the local, if n has square factor, then the local Galois representation becomes somewhat difficult to handle. So we have excluded that case. So n is square free, and we have a condition that for all prime dividing n, the conductor of the residual representation is same as the L. So we have this conductor hypothesis, and I'll make a comment about the corresponding hypothesis about Mazur and Rubin. And we say either one of these two condition holds. So this is the local condition at a prime L not equal to P. And then I have some condition at the prime P. So there are two conditions. So if there two cases we consider, either they are non-ordinary, something like what Professor Ghate spoke yesterday. So if it has non-zero slope, so it's a non-ordinary supersingular. And so in that case, we have this assumption that P is greater or equal to K and something like good. So this T1, T2 are zero. So the level of the modular forms are co-prime to P. On the other hand, if they are ordinary at P, then we assume P is greater than 2k minus 3, and either one of these two condition holds. So either it is good again, or if it is not good, then we have this, that the pth Fourier coefficient should not be equal to plus minus 1 mod pi. So then for every quadratic character chi of GQ, and every fixed j with 0 less than j less than k minus 2, we have an isomorphism of pi to the power r Selmer groups. Selmer block Kato AF1 chi minus j pi to the power r is isomorphic to Selmer block Kato AF2 chi minus j pi to the power r over Q. Okay. So they are pi to the power r Selmer companion, block Kato Selmer companion. So actually, I state this theorem for trivial Neven typers, but in our paper, it is also done for non trivial Neven typers, but it's just that the statement becomes mode notation and cumbersome, so I have removed it for presentation here, but we covered that case. So for Mazur Rubin, let me give a comparison. So they prove a similar theorem for elliptic curve. So the two things which are not there is, one I said, they cover the case p equal to 2, and they also allow additive reduction. So they allow, so if you take an elliptic curve, they allow square in the Niven type, square in the conductor. So for multiplicative reduction, our this condition is, so Mazur Rubin condition is at least as strong as this. So maybe our condition is slightly weaker. And at p, it is more or less the same, whatever they cover, we can also cover. So at least as general as what they do. Yeah. Yeah, but actually, okay, maybe it is the way I presented, because generally I have a Neven typus here also, and this condition is something depending on the Neven typus. So there are more factors here, and for trivial Neven typus, it comes out to be this. So it's possible that it's only satisfied for p equal to 2. But generally, it's a condition, so I have not written it down, but in our paper it's there. It's a condition depending on Neven typus, which also occurs. So then it can happen, certainly. But even if it's p equal to 2, it is included in our theorem, so we need that also. Yeah, so in the general, yeah, so let me repeat what I said. That in the general case, there is an epsilon I here, and this condition will change, and there will be some other factors here, which I haven't written down. So in that case, it can happen. And here also it can happen for p equal to 2. Okay, so let me now go to another motivation. Of this, so there is some link with this, with the p-adic function, so let me explain that. So I'm just recalling the definition of p-adic function, and I just do it for elliptic curve for again notational convenience. So suppose E is a elliptic curve with good ordinary reduction at p, then there is a power series in Iwasawa algebra tensor with QP, which has this following interpolation property. So by results of Shimura, we know that so this is a complex Hassewell L function of the elliptic curve, which has been already discussed. So its value at 1 divided by the period is g 0. The value of this power series at 0 is this. And generally, for any finite order character, phi of order p to the power n greater than 1, we have that g of phi t minus 1 interpolates this twisted L values. So this is a twisted L function, the value at 1 divided by the, again, the period, this is the Gauss sum, and this alpha beta are the roots of the polynomial x square minus apx plus p. So Mazur and Sunit and Dyer has constructed such p-adic function. And so and alpha p is a p-adic unit because we have this ordinary reduction. Then Wurzel has this congruence result that suppose, again, f1, f2 are p-ordinary, and let's say that residual representation is irreducible. Then if f1 and f2 are congruent mod pi to the power r, then for any Dirichlet character chi, such that, conductor of chi and n are coprime, we have this congruence of p-adic function, that L p f1 chi omega p bar, this is the tachymular character to the power minus j, the p-adic function of this and p-adic function of the corresponding thing with f2, they're congruent in the Iwasawa algebra. Okay, so this is so this is a congruence result established by Wurzel in the 80s, and maybe 1980s. No? No. No, but even with trivial, non-trivial name interpreter, this result is there in that paper. So now, so we continue to assume that this residual representation is irreducible. So assume that AF I pi is an irreducible GQ module, and assume that FI is again P ordinary. Then, so then by in this context, so we can consider the so we can consider the Pontryagin dual of the Selmer group over Q cyclotomic. And then by deep result of Kato, it is known that this is torsion. And under this hypothesis, so this is torsion over the Iwasawa algebra. And so finite attenuated torsion module, and by result of Greenberg, in general, for the elliptic curve, and maybe in this context by Himmert and Pollack Weston, so this has no pseudonal submodule. So these two properties hold, and then so we have this theorem. We stated this theorem for our result for but we can also, so in our paper, we extend these results for Qn also, where Qn is the nth layer of the cyclotomic extension. And then finally, we get, here there's a pi to the power r. So we extend these results over Q cyclotomic also, and then then using this result, and so we can identify this with we can establish this, and then finally we can get this using all this result for all quadratic character chi of GQ and J in this range, we can prove that the characteristic ideal of this, so this will be the Greenberg-Selmer group of AF1 twisted by chi omega P to the power minus J is same as the characteristic ideal of the Greenberg-Selmer group at F2 chi twisted by omega P to the power minus J over Q cyclotome. And these two are congruent mod pi to the power R. So in the Iwasawa algebra as ideals. So this is a characteristic ideal. So once they are torsion, you can associate a characteristic ideal. And so main conjecture of Iwasawa theory says that this guy is same as generated by this. This ideal is generated by this element, and this ideal is generated by this element. So if we have our result, then Iwasawa main conjecture plus 2 implies this one for all possible quadratic character chi. So that's how our result is related to Wurzel's result. So what we do, we prove this result, the main theorem I stated, I extend it to Q cyclotomic. And then using well-known results of Kato and Greenberg and et cetera, we can write down it is in this form, in the form of 2, that the whole P infinity Selmer group is congruent mod pi to the power R, their characteristic ideal. And now if your main conjecture is true, well, in many cases it is true due to Skinner-Urban now. So then we get that Iwasawa main conjecture plus 2 implies this, our relation 1. So our relation 1 is a precise, in that sense, algebraic reflection of the result of Wurzel. So that is the connection from the analytic side. But we must mention that the result, actually, if you want to prove this result about Q-cyclotomics, it's much easier. Proving over a number field requires more work. Okay, so but the theory of elliptic curve and modular form, so as I said, the proof is different, but there is important difference between the Selmer companionness. This property also has important difference for elliptic curve and modular form. So for example, Mazur Rubin say that they expect that given an elliptic curve E over K, there will be any only finitely many E prime, such that E prime will be P Selmer companion. And in fact, they say even if you don't fix the P, given an elliptic curve, even if you vary the P, then there will be only finitely many E prime, such that E and E prime are congruent. But this is clearly not the case in. And also, yeah, they prove that, so the main theorem they prove, which is similar, as I explained to our main theorem, that that there are only finitely many E prime, given an E, there are finitely many E prime. This is what they prove, that there are only finitely many E prime which satisfy the condition of their main theorem. And in general, they expect that there would be, although they do not prove it, they expect that there will be only finitely many E prime, so that they're companion to E. But our situation is clearly different. So you take a modular form F in S2 gamma naught n, P ordinary new form, and APF is not equal to plus minus 1 mod pi, and n is square free and P doesn't divide n. And further, you assume that this conductor hypothesis holds for every prime L dividing n. So then, of course, there are many such, one can construct easily, there are many such examples of weight two forms, where this pth Fourier coefficient is not, let's say, 1 mod p, and p doesn't divide n, and also this holds. Okay. Then, using Hida theory, one can easily see there are infinitely many forms fr, such that fr will be congruent to f mod pi, where fr will be, this is like the vertical, you fix the weight, but you vary the level, and psi r will be certainly corrected. You can produce many FR which are congruent to F. And then, so because of this property, FR will also satisfy the main all the condition of our theorem. So each F, so for each R, F and FR will satisfy all the conditions of our theorem. So F and FR will be pi Selmer companion for infinitely many FR. So this phenomena of Selmer companion, this is one example where it differs from elliptic curve and modular form. Okay, so now for the rest of the talk, so I give, first I define, how do you define this Bloch-Kato-Selmer group, and then I say a few things about proof, and then some numerical examples. Okay, so now I have to set up some notation to state the, to make sense of the Bloch-Kato-Selmer group. So let H be either F1 or F2, where F1 is Sk gamma naught np to the power ti epsilon I is a new form with P doesn't divide m. Then by results of Eichler, Shimura, Delin, and many others, there is a Galois representation attached to such H. And so VH is the representation space of rho H, which is two-dimensional vector space. And by compactness, we can fix a integral lattice in this, and then the discrete lattice is defined by VH mod TH. So this is something like two copies of QP mod ZP. So, and we fix sigma, a finite set of primes of Q, which contains the so-called bad primes, primes of a prime equal to P, and also contains those prime which divides the conductor of chi, where chi is the quadratic character. Okay. And omega p is the p-adic cyclotomic character. And then the twisted vector space is this, with diagonal action, and then there's a corresponding lattice once we have fixed the lattice. And again, we have a discrete lattice. Okay. So there's a general recipe how to define a Selmer group. So for each prime q in this sigma, So this sigma, the way we have chosen, is already large enough. So you choose a, for each prime sigma, you choose a subgroup. Let's call it dagger. So I'll specify later what this, so when dagger is block cut, what it will be, I'll specify later. So you choose a subgroup of H1, this local H1, the completion of Q at Q, and then this discrete lattice. So you take a subgroup of that. And then the pi to the power r points of that is obviously the subgroup of this. So we can, once we have defined this, we can define by the pullback in cohomology. It will induce a map in the cohomology, and this pullback is called H1 of QQ and AH chi minus j pi to the power r. And then once you have this, the definition of Selmer group is kernel of H1 of Q sigma. So Q sigma maximal unrified extension of maximal algebraic extension of Q unrified outside sigma. So this is the Galois group of that. So global, you have this discrete lattice, and for each Q, there is a restriction map to the decomposition subgroup. And then we have this chosen this subgroup, so you can take the quotient for each Q in Q. Then this kernel is the dagger Selmer group. Once I specify dagger, it will be for block cutter, then it will be the block cutter Selmer group. Okay. So now I'll say, now I'll specify dagger, and what I'll say, what is the block cutter Selmer group? Okay. Sorry? Oh, okay. Go ahead. Okay. So yeah, so I'll specify dagger and say what is the block cutter Selmer group. So I have a projection from this V to A, because A is just V mod T. So to define, so if I want to define dagger equal to block cutter, then it is enough to define it as a vector space level. Then I'll take the, so projection will induce a corresponding map in cohomology, and that image of the projection will be the block cutter condition at A. And what is the block cutter condition at V? It is defined to be unrified condition at Q not equal to P. And at P, this is the finite condition. So I will explain what these terminologies are. So at the moment, this is just two notations. It's a standard notation, so that's why I introduced it. So unrified means it is the kernel of, so H1 QQ to, you have a map to H1 IQ, where IQ is the inertia group. And this kernel is called the unrified condition. And I don't define what is, so B Chris. So this is the period ring of Fontaine. And you tensor V with this B Chris, and the kernel is H1F. Okay. So that is the block cutter Selmer group. So once we define this H1F, and once I define H1 unrified, then I have these definitions, and then I have this definition. And then I can go back and pull back to pi to the power r level. So then I have my block cutter Selmer group. So now this explains the notation of the statement of the theorem. And of course, the point is, for example, if it is an elliptic curve with good ordinary reduction, then it will coincide with the usual Selmer group of the elliptic curve. So the main idea of the proof, as in Weser-Rubin, is you compare. So you have these local conditions. So you compare this local condition in the definition of two block cutter Selmer group under this GQ isomorphism from AF1 pi to the power r to AF2 pi to the power r. And so generally the prime at P requires, local condition at P requires most careful analysis. So prime at P equal to difficult. So we don't have any abelian variety method for general weight K. So the proof is, our proof is different. So what we do, even before saying that, so let us also introduce the residual representation. So given a Galois representation like this, for the modular form, you can also attach a residual Galois representation. And we denote it by rho bar. So let me say what is the main idea. So at prime above, so let me first explain what is the main idea at unrified. So for prime not equal to P, which is the easier case. So this conductor hypothesis we had, this conductor hypothesis precisely means will hold if and only if this dimension thing matches. So dimension of the original vector space fixed by inertia should be same as the dimension of the residual Galois representation, that vector space fixed by IQ, and that dimension over, let's say, FP. So our condition means this. And why is this important? By theorem of Emerton-Pollack-Weston, using this we get basically, if this happens, then for f, then we get AFIQ is divisible. This is the result of Emerton-Pollack-Weston. And so our idea is that our hypothesis means this, but once you have this for f, what you need to do, you need to verify for once you twist by chi and then cyclotomic character to the power minus j, then you see that the same condition holds for, if it holds for h, then it holds for h chi minus j. So at each local place, you see what kind of representation you have, the local representation, and then you verify this condition. So if you have like the square dividing the level, then this became too difficult to compute. And hence we had to take the hypothesis that it is square free, which is standard in many paper and modular forms. Okay, so now this is the very short idea about the how to deal with primes not above p. And primes above p is a difficult case, so there we have two approaches. So generally the Selmer group nature is very different, whether the different reduction is ordinary or it is super singular. So if it is ordinary, we compare it to what is called Greenberg-Selmer group. So we define a Greenberg-Selmer group condition, and we compare this Bloch-Cotta-Selmer group with Greenberg-Selmer group. And if it is super singular, then there is a fundamental work of Shinsuchi Kobayashi. He has attached plus minus one Selmer group for elliptic curves. And there has been recent work of Florian Spang, and then Antonio Lai, David Loeffler, and Sarah Zarbis, and they, using that, they define plus one and two Selmer group, they call sine Selmer group for modular form, which are non-ordinary at P. So when the thing is non-ordinary, we'll compare it with the sine Selmer group. So this is the basically two methods, and what you do, you first prove the result for the Greenberg-Selmer group or Sine-Selmer group, and then you compare the Bloch-Cotta-Selmer group with Greenberg-Selmer group or Sine-Selmer group. So if H is p-ordinary, so by Wiles and Mazur-Wiles, H has a GQP filtration like this, where these are all co-free O-module, and the quotient is unified at p. And using this, one can define a Greenberg-Selmer group. So Greenberg-Selmer group is defined to be like this. So the Greenberg condition at a prime Q. So now dagger is Greenberg. So Greenberg condition at a prime Q. If Q is not equal to P, then it is like the unified condition, where except that instead of V, you directly define with A. And for the discrete lattice level, instead of vector space level, you can directly define with A. And if Q equal to P, then it is like the unified condition, but this has changed. Instead of A, you have this quotient A double prime here. So we first prove that this Greenberg-Selmer group is of F1 chi minus J is isomorphic to the Greenberg-Selmer group of F2 chi minus J for every chi and J in this range. And then we compare the Greenberg-Selmer group with the Bloch-Cotta-Selmer group. Okay. And if they're non-ordinary at P, then if K is not equal to P and P doesn't divide N, then there is this, as I said, there are a couple of Coleman maps, the fundamental work of Coleman attaches. So this is the Iwasawa cohomology, so this is defined as inverse limit of qp mu p to the power n, and let's say h is our modular form, then th, inverse limit of that is called Iwasawa cohomology. So from this Iwasawa cohomology, we have a map to Iwasawa algebra, couple of maps constructed by Coleman. And basically the work of Lai, Loeffler, Zarbis, they can see this Iwasawa cohomology using some Wach module and things like that. And they construct this plus minus, generalization of plus minus Selmer group, they call it sine Selmer group, one and two Selmer group. So they define one and two Selmer condition, and Lai, Loeffler, and Zarbis, and there is also a work of David Hetley and Antonio Lai. sorry. Sorry, yeah. Jeffrey Hadley and Antonio Lai. And so our idea is, first you show that Selmer group of F1 at pi to the power r is same as Selmer group of F2 pi to the power r. So here there are some technicalities. So this is cannot be defined unless this condition is satisfied, that it is good. So in particular, we cannot twist by a character which is ramified at p, quadratic character. So what we do, we go to q mu p, and there we prove that, so we want to prove the result for q, but we go to q mu p, and there, for this makes sense, this Selmer group makes sense, so we prove them, they're isomorphic. And then we compare it with the Bloch-Kato Selmer group. So finally we get Bloch-Kato Selmer group of AJ pi to the power, AF1 J pi to the power R q mu p is isomorphic to Bloch-Kato Selmer group of AF2 minus J pi to the power R over q mu p. And then from q mu p, there we can then we introduce the, once we are in Bloch-Kato Selmer group, then you can twist it by the character, even the character is ramified at p. And so then we come down from q mu p to q. So we first prove this for q mu p and trivial quadratic character, then we slowly come down to q. And finally, so one of the question which someone asked us that, notice in this theorem the weights are fixed because the critical values, if two weights are different, then the set of critical values will also be different. But suppose you have a, let's say, weight 2 and weight 3 Selmer group, then can we say they're Selmer companion? So if you allow that in the, for the common set of critical values, they are companion for those J in that range, then we have a similar theorem like this. And so we can prove that they are also Selmer companion in this sense. So we take the liberty of changing the definition because it doesn't make sense to say two different weight Selmer groups are Selmer companion because the set of critical values are different. But if you allow the common set of critical values and say that if all those critical values, those Selmer groups are isomorphic, then you call them, if you allow that definition, then we have a similar theorem like this, and then we can give examples also like this. Okay, so, and these conditions like p greater equal to k and so on here, I think there is a typo here, it will be p greater equal to k. So they come with their machinery of this signed Selmer group, so they cannot be improved. So now for the last 10 minutes or so, I discuss several numerical examples. So for example, this Kramer, Cremona and Mazur has this table, one of their papers. So they take these two elliptic curves, 1, 2, 4, 6, B and C. And let F and G in S2, gamma naught, this the corresponding modular forms. Then using LMFDB, we can write down their Q expansion. Then we can compute the minimal discriminant by result in Darmo, Diamond, Taylor paper, we can see that this conductor hypothesis is satisfied. Also these are irreducible, the residual representation are irreducible, and they are equivalent. So they satisfy all the condition of our theorem. So they, for example, are five Bloch-Kato Selmer companion forms. But using this, we can construct more examples. So this is elliptic curve still. So A to A5 equal to 2 and A5G equal to minus 3. So F and G are 5 ordinary. So again, by Hida theory, there is a primitive form F3G3 of weight 3 level 5 into this and Neven typus Teichmuller inverse such that F3 and G3 are congruent to this mod pi, where pi is a prime of KF3G3 lying above 5. Then as this condition is satisfied, this also satisfies for H and F3G3. So basically all the condition of our theorem is satisfied. So this is, you get an example of weight 3 forms, which are pi Bloch-Kato Selmer companion. And as I said in the beginning, by Hida theory, there will be infinitely many FR, such that F and FR are pi Selmer companion. That same weight 2, and where we vary the level like this. So here is another example. So this is the one example of ordinary case, and we indeed compute many examples, innovate 4 and so on, of ordinary cases, various examples. Some are good, some are not good. And so here is another example of super singular case. So this is in Damingan's Stein-Watkins paper, visible something related to visibility. So you have F of weight 4 and level 159, which is 3 into 53. And they're in this table, they're marked like this. And they're square free, and the Fourier coefficient of F is in Q. But Fourier coefficient of G generates a number field of degree 16. And we can take P equal to 5. Then we computed using SEDGE that A5 equal to F equal to 0. And this, as I said, in the machinery of the Stein-Selmer group, P is strictly greater than K is needed, so that is satisfied. And there's also a good prime, which is also needed, which is also satisfied. So the the super singular condition, so to speak, in our theorem is satisfied. And also, DSW said there is a prime such that above, so this is mentioned in their paper, that lying above 5 such that F is congruent to G mod P, where P is a prime. And using some level loading result of Ribet, they proved that that conductor hypothesis hold in the, this DSW paper. So we can verify that conductor hypothesis also. And then F and G are P block cutter Selmer companion forms. So yeah, and in our paper there are many such examples. And for the computation part, so creating this numerical example, these are the papers we looked. Yeah, so it's a bit early, but thank you for your attention. Yeah. So basically, okay, so we basically use some result of Lee-Loeffler Jarvis. So the main idea is this, that the block cutter condition is given by the kernel of dual perindrew exponential map. And so what they do in this, so not in this Hetley-Lee paper, in the Lee-Loeffler Jarvis, one of their paper, they connect the Stein-Selmer condition with this dual of exponential map. So this Coleman condition, so this is given by, so this, I don't have the formula, so this Coleman condition, so using this Coleman condition, so I can write a little bit at least. So you have this, so let me write, maybe it will be a bit more clear. So let's say I have Coleman map, it's Ni from Fi from H1 Iwasawa Qp Tf to and from Iwasawa in projection for any KV inside and then you define H1i of KV Tf minus j. So this is like, so there are two Selmer groups actually. So H11, let me write, if I want to define one Selmer group. So this will be
projection KV.
So you have this Coleman map here, right? So you take the kernel. It is a subset of Iwasawa cohomology. And from Iwasawa cohomology, you can project it to basically H1 KV. So you get H1 V T. So you get something on T, then you look at this image on V, and then you come down to A. So that's how you define this. So you define a T condition, then you go to V, and then you come down to A. So that is how you define the Sein-Selmer condition. But main thing to notice here that there is a kernel of Coleman map here. So what they do is the kernel of Coleman map, they have a formula which we apply in one of this Lee Loeffler Jarvis paper. Kernel of the Coleman map can be written as a combination of dual exponential map, exponential star map of Perrin-Riou. So something is in the kernel of Coleman map if and only if it is a kernel of the dual exponential map of Perrin-Riou. And dual exponential map of Perrin-Riou is the kernel of that also gives the Bloch-Kato-Selmer condition. So something is in the kernel of Bloch-Kato-Selmer group if and only if it is in the kernel of this Sein-Selmer group of Loeffler. Yeah. But this main idea is this. So you have kernel of Coleman map, then it is given by kernel of exponential star map of Perrin-Riou, and then exponential star Perrin-Riou map, we know it's the kernel of the Bloch-Kato condition also, because Bloch-Kato condition is defined like that. So that is the relation. And that conjecture also, I would like to just say that, because it captures the congruence in some sense, that conjecture is also worth investigating, but it seems difficult.